It is showtime.
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Was the Spencer Davis Group giving us Gimme Some Loving, one of the most classic rock and roll songs of all time. Hi, today is our first fall class. This is Dr. Minarcik. It's September 25th, it's Tuesday, and this is our sixth session in Global Online Medical School Pathology. And we're not going to put the word free on there because I hate it. We'll use the word no tuition instead. We're in Chicago, it's 9 o'clock, and I guess the first thing that we always have to do, and sometimes I forget, is to do the test, and I'm sure it's working anyway, but we'll do it anyway. First question is, can you hear me? And I'm seeing a million yeses. And the second question is, what do you see on your screen? Yes, the parrot. The parrot was given to us by Paula from Australia, who photographs birds, and she's given me quite a nice collection. This is the parrot by the name of Pinky, and she reminds us that Pinky bites. Well, I also wanted to announce that not only has Dr. Kamat been doing a very, very great job for us, and I want to thank him, but we also have taken on an announcer. So if some of you have gone to Facebook and seen the announcements for the classes, we had a very, very nice, beautiful friend of mine by the name of Shazina Metzger from Guyana do some video announcements for us. I think we're going to keep her because she does a really good job too. So thank you, Shazina, as well. Today, well, I think I'll talk about the music first. We started out with some good old-fashioned rock and roll. We're going to do things a little bit different today. We're going to have three beautiful, inspirational songs from the three largest cultures on planet Earth. These three songs will represent well over half of the population. We're going to start out with an Islamic song by the name of Insha Allah for the first song of the break. And then Dr. Kamat has given us a song, and I hope I can pronounce it right. It's called Yendi Gadaru. It's also a very inspirational religious song. And then we're going to end it all up at the break with Panis Angelicus from the Christian culture. So that's going to be our music for today. We'll end it with the usual inspirational rock and roll type stuff. And at this point, we could probably start talking about what we're going to do today. So let's talk about what we're going to do today. We're going to talk about hemodynamic disorders. This corresponds to chapter 4 of Robbins. And I don't know, I had a whole bunch of things I wanted to say about it, but I'm so excited about this chapter. I seem to have lost everything I wanted to say, but let me just tell you, this is my favorite chapter. You're going to hear that a lot. I'm going to try to tell you why this is the best chapter. First of all, it's very graphic. Second of all, there's very, very little to memorize. I'm not going to be throwing a lot of crap at you. You're going to be seeing stuff that flows, hopefully, like a Hollywood movie. There's very few words in the whole stuff. And the big thing is that it is clinical. Up until now, we talk about inflammation and degeneration and necrosis. We've been talking about scientific stuff. We're going to bring the patient into the pathology class and pathology lab now, because a lot of the stuff that you learn about in today's session and the next session will be things that you'll be actually doing when you get put on your nice white coat and get into the clinics. The bad news for today, and not really bad, but it's hemodynamics chapter is very, very long. It's 113 PowerPoints, and some of them are quite involved. So I wanted to tell you we're probably not going to have a lab today. We won't have labs every day. We usually have labs at the end of the chapter. So this chapter will take about 2 days. So today, Tuesday, we'll do hemodynamics 1 and next session. In 48 hours, Thursday, we'll do hemodynamics 2, plus the labs which are pertinent to what we talk about. Okay, well, let's get going. Here's the title page. I don't want to throw all this heavy mathematics at you first, because we're going to go into it later, but let's just say what we'll be talking about today is what we call hemodynamic disorders, but that also includes things like thromboembolic disease, shock. And if you had to summarize exactly what we'll be talking about today, we'll pretty much say it's just about everything that could go wrong inside of a blood vessel, except for the white cells and the blood vessel itself. So we talk about flow and lack of flow disorders. And this would be a good time to start laying down some basic definitions. A lot of these words you are familiar with already, and a lot of them are not really used properly even by medical people, so let's get them nailed down. Edema is fluid. Specifically, if you have a fluid compartment in your body known as ECF, or the extracellular fluid, and that's the water that's not in the cells, and it's not in the blood vessels, but it's between the cells. Edema is a shift in fluid from other compartments like blood vessels or cells into the extracellular fluid. Hyperemia is pretty much what you think it is. Hyper and emia, increased blood flow. Congestion, sometimes the words congestion and hyperemia are used interchangeably. I can understand that, but definitely congestion may appear like increased flow, but it is increased backup from a flow, usually due to an increase in hydrostatic pressure in a vein, resulting as backup and flow. And the best example of that is a congested liver in heart failure. Sometimes the term acute passive hyperemia of liver is used interchangeably with acute passive congestion. And I think if you Google both phrases, I think the hyperemia one will win out, but they're both very popular. Hemorrhage is bleeding. It's extravasation of blood. It's blood which is not limited to its endothelial lining, whether you're in a capillary or a vein or an artery or the heart or an aorta. It is a breaching of that endothelial barrier and escaping of blood and blood cells and blood components into the surrounding tissues. We now have the concept of hemostasis and thrombosis, and it's probably better to talk about thrombosis first, because thrombosis is basically all the forces in your body, normal forces, which contribute towards forming a blood clot. It's probably best to define hemostasis to say it's pretty much the opposite. So let's just say there is a homeostatic mechanism between thrombosis and hemostasis. Now remember, we said the word hemostasis and homeostasis all in the same sentence, so let's not confuse you. Thrombosis means clotting blood, making it hard. Hemostasis means keeping it liquid. And these forces are constantly in battle, and when one wins out over the other abnormally, then that's when you have a problem. An embolism is a thrombus, a blood clot, which has traveled downstream. Now, of course, if the original clot was in a vein, it's going to be going towards the lung, right? Anatomically speaking. If the blood clot was in the heart or aorta, then it's going to go away from the heart. So basically, it's simple geometry. Infarction is defined, even though we've talked about it before, as death or necrosis of cells and tissues due to lack of proper blood supply, which means inadequate oxygen and inadequate glucose and inadequate everything it takes to keep that tissue alive. Shock, in a way, can be thought of as total body infarction. Not exactly, because if the whole body was infarcted, the whole body would be dead. But shock is the processes which may lead up to it. It's very, very serious, and it could be defined as circulatory failure or circulatory collapse. Up until a certain point, it's reversible, but actually when you start reading the medical literature, when they talk about somebody in shock, they usually add right after that, and then the patient expired. Okay, let's start out with our first concept, edema, increased fluid. Now, there's only four ways you could get edema. I don't care if somebody tells you there's 10. There's only four. Because when you look at the pressures inside of a blood vessel, the pressure inside that blood vessel, ultimately determined by regular old blood pressure or the total force of that fluid within the vessel, whether it's artery, vein, or capillary, is called hydrostatic pressure. It's like the pressure inside of a hose, okay? The pressure which draws fluid back in, predominantly greatest on the venous end of the circulation, is called oncotic pressure. And that's not a hydrostatic pressure. That's sort of an osmotic pressure in a way, due to the fact that the blood has proteins, the most popular of which is albumin, made by the liver, which draws fluid back in. Another way to get edema is to obstruct lymphatics, which drain extracellular fluid. So, isn't that logical? If you obstruct the flow back into your lymphatics, you're going to get edema in the area that the lymphatics drain. And of course, if you remember from physiology, wherever sodium goes, the water goes. That's probably something you kind of remember up the wazoo from last year. So anything that retains sodium, whether it's on a renal basis or any other basis, even theoretically a dietary basis, would result in water retention as well. As long as we opened up the word and said water, let's talk about water. Everybody knows water is the majority, or we'll say 60% of your body. Now, most of that 60% is inside your cells. However, most of the rest of it is between the cells. That's called interstitial fluid. You could also call it the interstitial compartment. And even though you kind of think of a compartment as being a three-dimensional space, it's more of a physiologic concept, but it's also a space. It's the space between the cells. So when you have a shift in compartment from either the intracellular to the interstitial, or the intravascular, which is only 5% of your body if you do the math, into the interstitial, that's called edema. So edema is increased shift in fluid from either direction into the interstitial space, also called the ECF. Extracellular space is where you have interstitial fluid. And there you go, there's the definition right there. Now, you can also have increase in water in other anatomic entities as well. And let's get this straight right now, because there's a lot of words that are going to be confusing. So an increase of fluid in the pleural cavity, also called the thoracic space between the visceral and parietal pleura, is called hydrothorax. You'll very rarely hear somebody say hydrothorax. They'll usually say pleural effusion. It's the same thing. An increase in fluid in the pericardial space, water particularly, between the visceral and the parietal pericardium is hydropericardium. You'll very rarely hear it called that. You'll probably hear it called pericardial effusion. And of course, increase in fluid in the peritoneal cavity, the cavity that you put your hand into when you dissect your cadavers, surrounded on the outside by parietal peritoneum, the organs coated with visceral peritoneum, that's hydroperitoneum. Of course, you know nobody calls it that. They call it ascites. So hydroperitoneum is ascites, hydropericardium is a pericardial effusion, and hydrothorax is a pleural effusion. Now, if you substitute the word hydro for hemo, then instead of blood being in these spaces, you could say water being in these spaces. Then you say blood is in the space. So sometimes they go by these various names. The word anasarca is something that is not used very much, but it has a very specific definition. It's defined as increase in fluid everywhere. You could probably think of it as total body edema. Okay, so let's go into one of the first aspects of these various mathematical pressures. Let's talk about hydrostatic pressure. We said that hydrostatic pressure was like blood pressure. In fact, it's determined by blood pressure. Now think about it. If you put increased pressure on a blood vessel, like a vein, for example, that's draining ultimately into the heart, okay, then that's going to cause increased pressure, increased hydrostatic pressure within that vein, you know, proximal to your obstruction. And that's the basis for a lot of edemas. Impaired venous return will cause increased hydrostatic pressure proximal to that obstruction. And think about it, even though there are still forces in that vein, oncotic forces, the hydrostatic forces overwhelm them. So instead of that venous area returning fluid, it may gain fluid. Best overall example is congestive heart failure. You know, the heart just can't pump out the blood that's fed to it. You know, it violates Starling's law, okay? And therefore, anatomically and logically speaking, there's going to be a buildup in fluid from the veins that go into the heart. And that's pretty much the whole body, isn't it? What about if you constricted the heart with a pericardial inflammation, and therefore the heart simply had pressure on it from outside? Would that result in increased pressure as well? It certainly would. Now think about this. Think about the ascites of liver cirrhosis. Now everybody knows, you know, the liver makes albumin, and albumin is the main oncotic drawing force into the veins. But let me ask you this. I want you to think of cirrhosis as a liver that's scarred down. Now, if the liver is nothing more than a filter between the portal venous blood and the caval or the hepatic venous blood, and that filter is now scarred down and clogged, don't you think you'd have increased pressure within the portal system? Yes, and that's like one of the big, big explanations for increased fluid in ascites, and especially increased fluid in the organs that feed into the portal system. So you have a venous obstruction or a compression, maybe by a tumor, maybe mechanically, maybe by a clot. That's another reason for increased hydrostatic pressure. Thrombosis itself, external pressure, we said. Perhaps you have a lower extremity inactivations. Your patients that are on prolonged bed rest, they're just not pumping those leg muscles. They're just not, you know, using those valves to get that venous return. They might have edema secondary to that, or at least as a big contributing factor. Arterial dilatation might result from increased hydrostatic pressure. That makes sense, doesn't it? But it more likely might be an effect of this whole saga we talked about for the last couple of weeks called inflammation. Technically, heat could be a factor in increasing hydrostatic pressure. Think of a tea kettle that is under the flame. There's just increased pressure in there, isn't there? As well as a sort of a mysterious concept called neurohumoral dysregulation. So if we realize that the blood vessels are ultimately tied in with the sympathetic, particularly, system, there could be a dysfunction of that system resulting in increased hydrostatic pressure there as well. Let's talk about the other big force, oncotic pressure. Oncotic pressure is 100% dependent on the concentration of proteins in the blood. The proteins act as kind of an osmotic straw to counteract the hydrostatic pressure forces. So, the less protein you have in your blood, of which albumin is about 90% of it, by the way. I could just as easily have said hypoalbuminemia, but there is a few other proteins which contribute a little bit. The more protein you have in your blood, the better your oncotic pressure, the more drawing force you'll have into those blood vessels. If you have reduced protein, you're going to have reduced drawing force from the extracellular space into the veins, and therefore it's a contributor for edema. So let's say you're losing your proteins, you know, through having a defect in your glomerular basement membrane, like in glomerulonephropathies. You could be losing tons of albumin, tons of proteins, and that's one reason to reduce your oncotic pressure and cause edema. Ascites, we'll say it again, not only is liver the filter between portal and caval blood and could contribute to increased hydrostatic pressure in the portal veins if it's scarred down, but it's also the major producer of albumin. Okay, so that's another reason. The liver contributes both ways. People that are malnourished, not enough protein, will have low proteins in the entire body, including the blood. Malnutrition, starvation, is a very, very common cause of not only edema, but even anasarca, you know, even total body edema, severe hypoproteinemia. You can also lose proteins in your GI tract with a lot of the inflammatory bowel diseases, especially the one in which the mucosa is breached, like Crohn's disease, like ulcerative colitis. You're leaking out proteins, not just blood, out of that area as well. Okay, so we talked about the two big forces, the oncotic force and the hydrostatic force. Let's not neglect the lymph system as well. Now take a look at this little bullet of four things. What do they have in common? What they have in common is that any possible way you could injure lymphatic vessels will result in those vessels not doing what they're supposed to do, and that's drain extracellular fluid, okay? So if you have an inflammatory condition of the lymph vessels, a lymphadenitis, if you have those lymph vessels filled with tumor, if you have those lymph vessels traumatized or even taken out because of extensive surgery, especially breast surgery causing lymph edema, or if you have irradiated that area and those vessels are scarred down, any way you could damage the lymph vessels will result in those lymph vessels not being able to drain extracellular fluid ultimately into the thoracic duct and subclavian vein and therefore cause lymphedema. Finally, we can't ignore sodium. You remember, as sodium goes, there goes the water. So the amount of edema that you have in your body, the amount of fluid, is dependent on the amount of sodium. So technically, if you just ate nothing but salt all day, you'd have to take in a lot of water to make up for that salt, wouldn't you, to keep your electrolytes in normal concentration. If you had a disease of the kidney, which increased tubular reabsorption of sodium, or even a normal physiologic state, you know, like a renal hypoperfusion, which kicks in the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone axis to ultimately retain sodium. That's another cause of sodium retention. So when you think of people that have congestive heart failure, if you are an anatomic thinker, you think, well, you know, that heart just can't keep up with the venous return according to Starling's law, and therefore the venous return gets increased hydrostatic pressure, and therefore you have edema on that basis. But on the other hand, if you think, well, if your heart is failing and it can't perfuse the kidneys well enough, and there's now renal hypoperfusion, you're going to kick in that little axis, which will ultimately release aldosterone, which will ultimately result in tubular reabsorption of sodium and potassium excretion. Okay. What about inflammatory situations? We talked about, if you remember, one of the Marx brothers, we talked about the four classical signs of inflammation. One of them was called tumor, remember? And you're probably thinking, well, why is tumor part of inflammation? Well, it's because tumor just refers to swelling, anything that's a bump. So you hit somebody on the head with a hammer, they got a bump, they got a tumor. But that is a bump, not because of unregulated cell growth. It's a bump because the inflammatory process has started with the hyperemia and leakage of fluid, and perhaps later on by the ingrowth of new blood vessels. So these are three concepts to explain increased fluid in an inflamed area. Much more so in acute inflammation than in chronic, but also in the organization or neovascularization stages of inflammation. Another thing to remember is you have a lot of new blood vessels, increased flow going in there too. Okay, so now finally, after all of this rigmarole, I decide to whip this on you, and now you won't be too afraid of it. You see this JV, it's called the net fluid flux. That's the thing that we want to measure. Now, if you realize this, the big P over here is the hydrostatic pressure, and the little P, I don't know if I should call it a rho or a P, but it's a big Roman P, and there's a Greek pi. The pi represents the osmotic pressure, and the big P represents the hydrostatic pressure. And what they're basically saying is, if your hydrostatic pressure, certainly bigger on the arterial end of the capillary, will overwhelm the oncotic pressure, so the net fluid flux, or JV, will be into the ECF, ultimately picked up by the lymphatics. At the level of the capillaries, the flux is about equal. At the venous end of the vascular compartment, you could think of the vascular compartment either as anatomic or conceptual, like compartmental analysis. The colloid osmotic forces or pressures are greater than the hydrostatic pressures. But remember, obstruction at that point will increase the hydrostatic pressure so that arrow might go the other way. And you have to remember that fluid going into the extracellular space, the ECF, or if you want to call it interstitial area, is also constantly being fed into the lymphatic system. Okay, now you understand the Starling-Landis equation. Yeah, and it's the same Starling that gave us Starling's law of the heart, but Landis, I guess, joined him on this one. Okay, what about the edema due to congestive heart failure? Two things. If you have a failing ventricle, then it can't keep up with the fluid given to it. You know, that's a regular Starling's law. And therefore, that venous pressure is going to increase. And therefore, the pressure will possibly even surpass the oncotic pressure going in the other direction. You're going to get edema. And specifically, when the venous systems drain into the right ventricle, you're going to get systemic edema predominantly. If the venous systems drain into the left ventricle, the primary edema will be pulmonary. Now, it's nice to think of it that way, and that's one of the big classifications for congestive heart failure, right versus left heart. But the fact is, when you have right heart failure, you can get a little bit of edema all the way backing up into the systemic and vice versa as well. But also, this is the way I think. I'm an anatomic head, okay? For those of you out there that are physiologic heads, and you know, I don't think it's the majority of you, but I tell you, the physiology heads are smarter than the anatomy heads. I just happen to be an anatomy head. But for those of you who want to think physiology, think of a failing heart as also causing inadequate renal perfusion. And you know what happens there from physiology in much greater detail than I do. You're ultimately going to kick off that aldosterone, resulting in sodium retention, which is another reason for edema. So both reasons. When I was a medical student, I went up to a bunch of professors and I said, well, what's really the important one? And some of the professors said, this one is, and some of them said that. And really, I think most of the really smart ones probably think physiologically rather than anatomically. Here's hepaticocytes, and once again, here's the two reasons for edema in hepaticocytes. Well, edema of organs, you know, like the spleen, like the pancreas, like the bowel, are going to be particularly significant in portal hypertension, okay? Because that's the area that drains into those veins. So that's why the predominant fluid in cirrhosis is abdominal fluid or ascites. However, there's also a systemic counterpart because the liver is now not making enough albumin to drive that oncotic force, and therefore you can have systemic or venous edema as well. There's your ascites, okay? You know that this is not just a fat person, or maybe you think it might be a fat person. And when you go into the clinics, you're going to see patients like this, and you're going to go, come on, does that person have ascites, or is he just fat? Well, you know, there's something called a fluid wave. If this person was only fat and you tapped on that abdomen, you wouldn't feel the echo of the water on the other side of the abdomen. So that's basically a way of determining obesity from ascites, and that's something you're going to be doing a lot of. What about renal edema now? We already know that ischemic kidneys retain sodium because of the access and therefore cause edema. But remember, the albumin and other proteins that are filtered by glomeruli in glomerular diseases might have defects in the glomerular basement membrane, and now actually protein starts leaking out of that membrane, which it's not supposed to, and therefore you have a protein losing glomerulonephropathy. Okay, and those usually result in nephrotic syndrome, where you have hypoproteinemia, you have a lot of edema, and for some strange reason, the body tries to kick in for your lack of oncotic pressure by telling the lipids to act more like an oncotic device. So they also have hyperlipidemia as well. So those are the three features of nephrotic syndrome, which we're going to go into in great detail. Here's some adjectives for edema. Okay, subcutaneous edema, you know, that means when you press on the patient's skin, you'll see a little pit there for a while, maybe a few minutes. And depending on how much of a pit there is or how long it takes to return back to normal, might be a good test for, you know, whether your therapy is helping that edema or not. Sometimes the word dependent edema is used with respect to gravitational organs, you know, especially the legs, that if you just sit too long or you're immobilized too long and you're not getting enough venous return, sometimes the word dependent edema is used. And of course, that would be more likely to happen in a person with heart failure, you know, particularly right, possibly more than left for anatomic reasons. Total body edema, anasarca. Okay, I don't think you'll ever use that word when you're in practice, but it's nice to know what it means. I don't know if you'll ever see a patient with it. You know, the people that are in countries where there's a lot of starvation and severe lack of, you know, liver function and proteins will present with anasarca. And of course, the edema will be a different pattern, technically, whether it's right or left heart. Sometimes the word periorbital edema is used, like you see here. And of course, originally, periorbital edema is often attributed to renal edema. But if you'd studied a little bit more, you know, it's just a lot of subcutaneous edema in the eyelid area. Pulmonary edema would be the result of a significant right heart failure, or if there was such a thing as a selectively right heart failure. Left heart failure. Pulmonary edema would be the result of a predominant left heart failure, whereas systemic edema would be more right. But, you know, it's never really purely one or the other. It's always both. You know, and that's also true with effusions. You know, I'll go back up a little bit and tell you that when you look at a patient that has ascites, you do a CT on them or MRI or an autopsy, you see a lot of fluid in that abdominal cavity, ascites. Well, there's a good chance that there's a pleural effusion as well. Might not be as big or noticeable, but it's usually there. So significant collections of fluids in your mesothelial lined three body spaces, especially if they're significant, usually result in increase in fluid in one of the other two mesothelial lined spaces as well. Now, let's take the brain for example. How would you know if the brain was edema? Because the brain doesn't swell. It can't press on the cranium to look like the head is swollen. So in the case of a brain, which is in a closed bony jail or cavity, you will have edema or swelling or pressing of parts of the brain that are in proximity to areas which theoretically have a little bit of play with respect to the bones and the dural membranes. So there's often a herniation at the cerebellar tonsils where you have those big spaces, your cisterns, also over the tentorium, and also at the fox. Those are the three areas. I'm going to show you a picture of that in a minute. Fluid. Okay, we've so far been talking about fluid as though it was water because we're talking about Starling's forces. And so technically a transudate would be sort of like pure water, which means it's going to be very low in specific gravity. It's going to be very low in protein content. And it would have a low LDH as well. Why? Because LDH is a cellular enzyme. So if you don't have any cells in there, you're not going to have much LDH. On the other hand, if the fluid is associated with damage in those endothelial lined spaces, you're going to have leakage of much more than just pure water. You have leakage of cells, You're going to have leakage of proteins. And now your fluid is going to have a higher specific gravity. So usually about 1.012 is the dividing line between transudate and exudate. But also a protein content is important too. So usually the exudates have more than 3 and more than 1.02, and the transudates are lower. And don't forget, in the exudate, which is leaking proteins, it might also be leaking cells as well. So now your LDH measurement is going to be high. Those are the three things that you might consider when you're wondering if your pleural effusion, you know, when you go through a process of sucking out that pleural effusion with a needle, you know, and you did a good job, the least the lab could do for you is take that fluid and tell you whether it's pure water or whether it's perhaps fluid that is loaded with cells like tumor cells or fibrinogen or whatever. Hyperemia versus congestion. Sometimes the words are used interchangeably. I am guilty of that myself, but technically hyperemia is increased flow from the arterial end, from the end of the vascular bed that's closest to the heart. Okay? So there's hyperemia, there's normal. Now congestion might look like hyperemia because you see pathologically big dilated spaces engorged with blood, and you're tempted to say that that's increased flow or hyperemia, but what it actually is increased backflow or decreased outflow would be a better way of doing it. So the hyperemia that you see with increased hydrostatic pressures inside of veins are usually due to decreased outflow, but they may look exactly, microscopically, like those big congested vascular spaces with theoretically something that increases the flow, you know, like acute inflammation. So there you go, hyperemia is an active process, congestion is a passive process. If somebody would like to Google the term liver acute passive hyperemia and liver acute passive congestion and see which one wins, please let me know. Put a little note on there if you got time to Google it. I think that hyperemia will win, but I might be wrong. So there you go. So we said congestion was obstruction to venous flow, backflow, increased hydrostatic pressure. That can happen in the lung, that could happen in the liver, and that could happen anywhere. But in these two organs, we often talk about whether that congestion is acute or chronic. So you have acute congestion in the lung or chronic congestion in the lung. You have acute congestion in the liver, chronic congestion in the liver. Even the brain can be congested. They normally would not divide it into acute and chronic, but we're going to see the results of edema and brain congestion. Now think of it this way. If you have acute congestion in the lung, that's just water. Okay? You have a normal lung, but rather than air being in the alveoli, you see water. Okay? Now, if you have a long-standing congestion, that water is eventually going to break down some of the septae. It's going to result in a little bit of blood escaping. And if it's chronic enough, the breakdown of that blood, of that iron, will eventually result in hemosiderin, and then your macrophages will start chewing it up. So, that's pure water in the lung, and that's a lung where the alveoli are not filled up with water, but probably hemosiderin-laden macrophages. Here's a liver now, and let's say that you have a heart failure. And let's say it was predominantly a right heart failure, so you got increased flow in that liver. Well, all you're going to see acutely is increased flow. Now, if the flow in the liver goes from the portal triad to the sinusoids, to the central veins, to the hepatic veins, to the vena cava, okay, then in an acutely congested liver, you're going to see the predominance of the central part of the lobule, because that's the lobule that's closest to the caval our hepatic blood flow. If that's chronic enough and is congested enough, the central portion of that labial will eventually become necrotic. So in the liver, chronic congestion is associated with the concept of central labular necrosis. When you hear the term central labular necrosis, you're probably talking about a liver that has been chronically congested. There you go. There's acute pulmonary edema. And like I say, what's the difference between a normal lung and acute pulmonary edema? Water. That's the only difference, okay? Basically, the septae are still in pretty good order. The alveoli are wide open, but they're filled with water now. That's strictly transudate, isn't it? This could be an acute left heart failure. You know, acute pulmonary edema, very often listed as top of the list in medical examiner's reports. Somebody dies of an acute heart problem or even things like drug overdoses. You know, this is a frothy lung. Here's what it might look like while the patient's still alive, gets an x-ray. You generally, in all honesty, even if you're not a radiologist, like I'm not a radiologist, all you would say there's some kind of increased fluid, and it seems to be a little more severe on the gravitationally dependent portions. That makes sense, doesn't it? Because water generally follows gravity. So you can get edematous lungs, and you're standing up. You're probably going to have more edema in those lower lobes than in the upper lobes, or what the radiologists would call lung fields, because the actual, as you know, lower lobes can extend about as high as this. The two things that which you'll hear about on your radiologist report with acute pulmonary edema, he might use the word curly B line, which, you know, makes you think, well, is there a curly A and a C? Well, there probably is, but the curly B lines are little linear thickenings of the septae between the bronchopulmonary segments. And the air bronchogram is an interesting concept as well with acute pulmonary edema. And here's how you explain both of them. And if you look at a normal lung, you remember that sometimes you can see relatively clear spaces where there's larger bronchi and they're lucent spaces because that's big pure air, but they're also surrounded by things which are relatively filled with air too, like lung. But if that lung is filled up with fluid, the contrast between the pure air in the bronchus and the lack of air in the surrounding lung is going to make these bronchi look a little more prominent. And you see this little line here? Well, it's a straight line, and you might want to call it a curly line, but it's not C-U-R-L-Y, you know, like something that's curled. It's called curly because of, I don't know, maybe he was a famous radiologist, but a curly B line would correspond to an area that's a separation in a bronchopulmonary segment, a little bit more prominent because it's surrounded by water on each side. Similar to what we saw here, the air being surrounded by water on each side. Okay, those are the two big terms. Now, we told you that in acute pulmonary edema, you basically have water in the alveoli, and I think you'd still recognize these as being alveoli, I hope, even though it looks like they might be leaking stuff, and they're obviously leaking blood, and you see blood in here. But the blood's been in there long enough to actually degenerate into hemosiderin pigment, and now that hemosiderin pigment is being chewed up by macrophages. And by the way, if this was a patient that walked into your office and you just got a sputum specimen on him and you stained that sputum specimen with iron stain, or you just looked at it under a regular microscope, you could probably see those hemosiderin macrophages in his sputum. That's why they are called heart failure cells. And it's just another way, and probably not going to be used very much, but technically you could use that to substantiate your diagnosis of heart failure, though more likely you can do 20 or 30 more scientific tricks. There you go. There's those same cells inside of alveoli. Are now they're stained with Prussian Bro blue, which you know is pretty specific for staining hemosiderin very, very dark bluish green. Now, I want to show you my favorite picture of this whole thing. And you see that? You all know that's a liver. And you also know that when you see a large space in the liver, it has to be a vein, right? Now, If that large space doesn't appear to have any connective tissue or bile around it, that's a hepatic vein. And guess what? If that large space looks like it has a little bile duct, or it squeezes out a little bit of greenish yellow at the edge of it when you squeeze the surface, then you know that that's a portal vein, okay? And that goes whether you're talking about the large veins or the small veins. Now, this is why this is my favorite picture. In fact, I'm going to pop open the question window right now. See all these little red dots? Just say yes or no. I know you do. Now take a look. Do you see, if you really had good eyes, you don't need a magnifying glass, and your eyes are better than mine. But you see that one red dot? You see that one red dot? You see that one red dot? See that one red dot right there? Yeah, it are red dots, and it's kind of a more brownish background. What is that one red dot? That's a central vein. Isn't that amazing? This is why I love it, because who says that you need a microscope to examine central veins? You're seeing them now with your naked eye. The reason why you're seeing them is because they're ingested. They're engorged with blood, because that central vein is going into the hepatic veins, and your hepatic veins are increased pressure because the ventricles is failing, and your atria are also in increased pressure. You got a single congested hepatic vein, and look, it's filled with blood. So that's acute passive congestion of the liver. If that was there long enough, because the central portion of the vein is not getting enough flow relative to the portal end of the labial, which has nice arterial blood flow, then it's the central portion of the vein that becomes necrotic. So that's acute passive congestion. And there it is microscopically. It's chiefly blood cells in around that central vein. But as you go on in time, look at, you have necrotic cells. You have granular cytoplasm. You have loss of nuclei. And it will eventually look like a nutmeg. Now, I know most of you have never seen a nutmeg, and if I was in your classroom, I would get a bunch of nutmegs and throw them into the audience. But a nutmeg looks a lot like this. So the chronic passive congestion of the liver is often called a nutmeg liver. I don't think there's ever been a pathology course where they haven't mentioned this. Okay, what about organs like the brain? You know they can't expand. And you're looking, you know you're looking at a brain. I don't have to tell you that. You could see the gyri. You could see the sulci. Now, let me ask you this. If this brain was edematous and it couldn't expand, do you think that the gyri would become a little flattened? In other words, they wouldn't have a nice round aspect to them. They'd be kind of flat because you're taking a cerebrated substance and you're pressing it against the inside of a bone, basically. So flattened gyri are regarded as being indicative of cerebral edema. It could be localized. More often than not, it's generalized. But remember, even though that brain can't expand because it's in that wall called the cranium, it can protrude through areas that have a little bit of play. And I think I have a diagram of that right now. Do you remember the falx? Remember, it's an extension of dura and connective tissue from the sagittal sinus. Well, right underneath the falx, before you get to the corpus callosum, technically you have a theoretic space. So even though these gyri and sulci can do nothing but become flatter once they hit the bone in the dura, there is technically, if there was edema predominantly right-sided here, it could cause some herniation of brain tissue across the falx, in the most inferior portions of the falx. That's called a subfalcine herniation. And, of course, if the entire brain was edematous, you probably wouldn't see it because both sides would want to cross the falx. However, in a diffuse cerebral edema, you can have both portions of your hippocampus here trying to herniate from the middle to the posterior cerebral fossa by crossing that tentorium. So just like the fox, the tentorium doesn't, you know, poke right into the brain. There's theoretically a small space there. So if you do an autopsy and you see that the hippocampus is kind of bending or trying to protrude through that tentorium, then you could say that's probably edema. And if it's bilateral, you know it's probably general edema. And remember, at the basal portion of the cerebellum, there are those big cisterns for cerebral spinal fluid. And technically, part of the cerebellar tonsils can herniate into those spaces as well. So those are three areas that you would see abnormal if there's general edema of the brain. And we'll probably talk about this again when we talk about brain. Now, what time is it? It's 9:53. We're done with edema, and we're going to go into the concept of hemorrhage now. And I think this is a good time to take a break. And remember, we are not going to do a lab today. In fact, we probably won't even finish this whole chapter today. It's a huge, wonderful chapter, and we're only 32 out of 113 PowerPoints. So maybe we'll do another 30 in the second hour. Question before we take the break. Do you agree with me that this has been the best one so far, or am I being delusional? I just love this chapter. Okay, thanks for sharing my excitement. I'm going to close your PowerPoint there, and we're now going to play music, inspirational, religious, beautiful music representing the three major cultures of planet Earth. We'll start out with Islam, we'll go into Hindu, and then we'll finish it off with Christian. See you in 10 minutes, folks. Thank you.
ದಿಗಾದರು ನಿನ್ನ ಪಾದಾರವಿಂದವೇ ಗತಿ ಎಂದು ನಂಬಿದೆನೋ, ಎಂದಿಗಾದರೂ ನಿನ್ನ ಪಾದಾರವಿಂದವೇ ಗತಿ ಎಂದು ನಂಬಿದೆನೋ. ಬಂಧು ಬಳಗವ ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಬಂದೆ ನಿನ್ನ ಮನೆಗಿಂದು, ಬಂಧು ಬಳಗವ ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಬಂದೆ ನಿನ್ನ ಮನೆಗಿಂದು. ಮಂದರಧರ ಗೋವಿಂದ ಪುರಂದರ ವಿಠಲನೆ ನೀ ಬಂಧು. ಅನ್ಯರೊಬ್ಬರ ಕಾಣಿ ಮನ್ನಿಸುವರೆನ್ನ, ಅನ್ಯರೊಬ್ಬರ ಕಾಣೆ ಮನ್ನಿಸುವರೆನ್ನ, ಆಪನ್ನ ರಕ್ಷಕನೇ ಪರಿಪಾಲಿಸು. ಇನ್ನು ಪನ್ನಗ ಶಯನ ಶ್ರೀ ಪುರಂದರ ವಿಠಲನೆ ಬಂಧು. ಬಾರಿ ಬಾರಿಗೆ ನಿನ್ನ ಚರಣಕ್ಕೆ ಶರಣೆಂದೆ, ಬಾರಿ ಬಾರಿಗೆ ನಿನ್ನ ಚರಣಕ್ಕೆ ಶರಣೆಂದೆ. ಭಾರತೀ ರಮಣನೆ ಬಾರೋ ಮನೆಗಿಂದು, ಭಾರತೀ ರಮಣನೆ ಬಾರೋ ಮನೆಗಿಂದು. ತಂದೆ ಶ್ರೀ ಪುರಂದರ ವಿಠಲರಾಯನೆ, ಎಂದೆಂದಿಗೂ ನೀನೆ ಜಗಕ್ಕೆ ಬಂಧು.
beautiful music that represents about two-thirds of the people on planet Earth. You know, probably most of you remember or know who Salvador Dali is. He's one of the most famous painters in the world, and here's a funny story about him. It's a little bit crude. Somebody once asked him, when is your most inspirational moment of the day? And Salvador Dali said, you know, it's when I wake up in the morning and I make a pee-pee, and that pee-pee moment is basically the inspiration that drives me the whole day. And I'll tell you, I have my pee-pee moment during the break, because then I already have at least one or two cups of coffee in me, and that's when I get my great ideas. And it's always something I never thought of, and I should have thought of saying. And I can say anything here, okay? I could say anything I want. If you don't like it, too bad. I can offend anybody I want. I try not to offend anybody, but we just heard music representing the gods that the Islamic people call Allah, and Hindu people have a god, and Christian people have a god. And even though our corrupt governments, you know, of which the United States is probably the worst, even though we are taught sometimes to disrespect or fear or hate the people of opposite faith, we all know what the truth is. So that's what I want to say, and I'm glad I said it. Let's get back to pathology now. We spent the entire first half talking about the concepts of fluid and edema as the first part of our discussion on hemodynamic disorders. And now we're going to talk about blood. We're going to talk about hemorrhage. We're going to talk about clotting. We're going to talk about what clots do. And this is a good time to do some definitions, as always. Everybody knows what blood is. Everybody's bled before. And it's basically, if you consider your blood cells, your blood itself confined, whether it's in a heart, an aorta, an artery, a vein, or a capillary, to be lined by endothelial barriers. Even though some of these endotheliums have little holes in them to cause sinusoids or fenestrations, hemorrhage is extravasation beyond a blood vessel. Sometimes the word hemorrhagic diathesis is used. And the funny thing is, even though diathesis is a generic word, it's almost always preceded by the word hemorrhagic. And a hemorrhagic diathesis is a situation in which abnormal bleeding is occurring, perhaps not even with respect to a known traumatic source, but just abnormal chemicals inside of the blood volume. A hematoma implies that there's a mass effect, because that word oma is in there. So a hematoma is a blood clot, and it is a pre-mortem blood clot. It's something that happens before you die, and often is the cause of why you die. And it's pressing around its neighbors, and that's called a hematoma. Sometimes you'll hear the word dissecting hemorrhage, and dissection of hemorrhage is a term that's used usually in respect to large arterial vessels, and especially the aorta. So you'll hear about a weakening of the wall of an arterial blood vessel, and because of that, the blood in that is actually dissecting into the planes of the wall of the blood vessel. Now, these next three terms are all the same. The only difference is the size. Usually hemorrhage that's visible, and skin is the best example, although the surgeons use it when they're looking at organs in the body, too. Petechial hemorrhage or petechia are pinpoint, and they're usually no more than about 1 or 2 millimeters. I would hate to draw the line. A purpura, purplish, is bigger than 2 millimeters. But less than 1 centimeter. Now, an ecchymosis, often called a bruise, are areas of hemorrhagic discoloration, and they're usually more. So usually they'll, when you see a patient with hemorrhages, you'll say either petechial, purpura, or ecchymosis. If they're pinpoint, it's usually due to decreased platelets or a platelet disorder. And of course, it's almost never purely one or the other. So if somebody's talking about purpura, if you look closely, there may be some petechiae, or some of those purpuras may be more than 1 centimeter. So you call it by its predominant form. Now, just like we talked about fluid within these so-called mesothelial lined spaces, pleura, pericardium, peritoneum. You can also talk about hemo or blood. So a hemothorax would be the bloody counterpart of a hydrothorax. Hemopericardium is the bloody counterpart of a hydropericardium or pericardial effusion. And a hemoperitoneum would be the counterpart, the bloody counterpart of an ascites. Technically, even the lined synovial spaces within joints, you can hear the word hemarthrosis. And of course, we've already seen some examples of hemorrhage being acute, which is red, or chronic, which is invariably loaded with hemosiderin that's always predominantly chewed up by macrophages. And also remember, evolution of hemorrhage occurs as well. So we said that in an acute hemorrhage versus a chronic hemorrhage, the acute hemorrhages or an acute ecchymosis is generally purple. That's why they're called purpura. But as that hemoglobin basically starts undergoing chemical changes, it goes into a variety of bilirubin type compounds, it turns green. And then ultimately it becomes hemosiderin, and the hemosiderin being chewed up by the macrophages give it a brownish tinge. So as you go from acute to chronic hemorrhage in your evolution, the basically colors go from a reddish purple to a greenish yellow and getting darker all the way to brown. And during that color change, you're also doing a chemical changes as well. Hemoglobin to bilirubin compounds to hemosiderin. And you know, in MRI, you actually can do things with your magnet to tweak areas chemically, so you could determine whether a hematoma in a brain, for example, is predominantly bilirubin or hemoglobin. Of course, on the outside of the body, the easiest way to do it is to just look at the color. So that's the evolution of hemorrhage. Here's some nice pictures of hemorrhage. Here's a bowel that's opened. And even though you might use the word petechiae with skin, I think you could probably say that there are petechial hemorrhages within the mucosa of this opened gastrointestinal organ. Well, it looks like it's a large bowel to me, but I could be wrong. There is a hematoma there pressing on a brain. In fact, there's two of them. Here is an ecchymosis, which means it's long been 1 centimeter. It still looks purplish, so it still looks recent. The one here looks like it's might be getting sort of a yellowish orangish tinge. That could probably be a little bit more bilirubin type compounds in there. There's something that's pretty black. I don't know, could that be chronic hemorrhage in that subungual hematoma? It very well could be. These are the many faces of hemorrhage. Here's some hemorrhage in the brain. In this case, it was a subdural, okay, because it's below the dura. Here you can see some lighter meninges making the gyri and sulci a little bit visible. Here's a collection of blood subdurally. Here would be a nice diagram of that. And basically, the three major areas of the brain that four major areas of the brain that hemorrhage occurs would be subdural, usually in closed head injuries, epidural, usually associated with skull fractures. So there's your dural membrane. If it's sub, it's probably a closed head trauma. If it's epi, on the other side of that little membrane, good chance it's associated with a brain fracture. It could be intraventricular. It could be intraparenchymal. Of course, the last place for hemorrhage to occur, especially if it occurs with regards to a busted blood vessel or a broken aneurysm, would be subarachnoid. So those are the four or five places where hemorrhage has occurred. Each one has different reasons. Here's some more hemorrhage. Sometimes you could tell, for example, I believe this is small bowel. In fact, I'm sure it is. You can see that the hemorrhage is not only along the serosa, but probably dissecting into the wall. Here you may have a free blood clot over here. It's red, it's purple, you know, this is recent. Here's a MRI. I'm sorry, this is not an MRI, this is a CT, because the bones look very, very dense. But it's a very good CT, and you can see that there is a right lobe of the liver here. Here's a left lobe, that's probably the stomach. This kidney here probably has a contrast agent in the pelvis. You can see a nice delineation between the cortex and the medulla, generally speaking. But in this kidney, you see some irregular separation, sort of a curvy linear. And you can imagine that if you open that up, there just might be a hematoma there. Or you theoretically, there could be anything that interrupts the anatomic integrity of that kidney. Here's a brain. And you know that this is MRI, because the skull is not the densest thing, it's the least dense thing, if you don't mind the word dense. Here you can see that there's some hemorrhage along here. And rather than try to figure out whether this is epidural or subdural, you have to remember that in MRI, you can pretty much tweak your magnetic pulses, or I don't know if there's a better word for them. You could tweak the way you magnetize and line up those protons to get some idea of what chemical is underneath there. So that just measures density, it measures chemicals. And depending on whether that is hemoglobin or bilirubin compounds or hemosiderin, you can pretty much tell the difference. But at least you know from this that there the hemorrhage is along here on the external aspect of the brain. And I'm not going to make any more guesses above that. Hematoma versus clot. Okay, well, if a hematoma is actually obstructing something, you know that it occurred before the patient died. If it's a clot, it may have occurred before the patient died. That would be called a thrombus, wouldn't it? That's a pre-mortem blood clot. But on the other hand, if you remember when you were dissecting through your heart and your big arteries in anatomy lab, you saw a lot of dried blood clot in those big vessels, and you're probably all wondering, oh my God, would this thing obstruct the vessel? Well, most likely, the blood just settled and became hardened, especially if there was if it was fixed for a long time with embalming fluid or formalin. So clots can be either pre- or post-mortem. Okay, we're going to get into that a little bit later, but now let's talk about the concept of hemostasis. I guess in a way you could say that hemostasis is a lot like homeostasis, because it is the counterbalancing force to all of the forces that create a thrombus. Hemostasis is the process by which the liquidity of blood is preserved and maintained, versus thrombosis, in which the total forces are the hardening or the clotting or the coagulation of blood. And usually the plug or the hardening or the clot or the thrombus is in sites of vascular injury. Okay, that's the general rule. Now, to summarize the next 20 or so PowerPoints, you have to remember that thrombosis has basically three areas and three main acts in this big saga. The earliest one is the vascular wall, the endothelium, the injured endothelium, either anatomically or physiologically, with the extracellular matrix underneath. Okay? The next big act in this Shakespeare play is the platelet interface with this injured vascular wall. A whole series of events happens here too. Finally, the classical thing that we call coagulation, you know, the cascade of the various blood clotting factors comes in. And that's the final act of the Shakespearean play. So, let's talk about the sequence of events following a vascular injury. Okay, let's talk about the early phases. Well, the first thing that happens when you injure a blood vessel and you mess with that endothelium is that there's arteriolar vasoconstriction. That's a normal response to cut off the flow to the area that's injured so you don't bleed to death. Part of it is a reflex neurogenic response, but also damaged endothelium issues, maintains, creates, releases a substance called endothelin, very appropriately named because it comes from endothelial cells, and that further acts to constrict the blood vessels. Okay? Now, the thrombogenic extracellular matrix, which is exposed once that endothelium is breached, causes an adherence to the platelets. Okay? The platelets then adhere. They degranulate with their granules. They aggregate as the third factor. And up until now, that's just called primary hemostasis. We haven't really got into the full coagulation cascade yet. Now, a factor called tissue factor is released in conjunction with the endothelium and the platelets, which so far has been the main players. And that tissue factor then triggers off the coagulation cascade. And of course, it has the coagulation cascade has both an intrinsic as well as an extrinsic portion to the long diagram. And that's finally the formation of the fibrin clot is called secondary hemostasis. And if you think that's the end of the movie, it's not, because then a lot of things happen with that fibrin. It can get stronger. It can also become dissolved by another process called fibrinolysis. Okay, so that's kind of like a little mini summary of the thing. I guess I might call this my most important PowerPoint. Why it's not in yellow, I don't know. But let's just review the cast again. Endothelium, the platelets, and the coagulation cascade. If you want to think of the three axes having these players as their main actors, you can. Let's go with endothelium. Okay, you know what an endothelial cell is? Technically, it's epithelial, but it's flat, it's thin, it's probably what you would call non-stratified squamous. And it lines the inside of all vascular spaces, whether you're in the heart or a vein or aorta or artery or a venule or an arteriole or anything. Some of, usually at the capillary level, is nothing more than a single endothelial cell. Sometimes it holes in it, depending on which organ you're in, called fenestrations. Sometimes when the vessel is dilated for some reason, there can be endothelial gaps. We saw that with inflammation. But normally, endothelium has a lot of properties which favor hemostasis, or the opposite of thrombosis or coagulation. In other words, it has properties which are antiplatelet, it has properties which are anticoagulant. In addition, it has properties which also dissolve fibrin if it's being made. On the other hand, when this endothelium is injured, it does the opposite. It has all of the forces which accelerate and enhance coagulation. So, before we talk about this particular movie, we're going to show you actually what endothelium is. I think if you're not familiar with electron microscopy, you know this is a small lumen. You know that these are the nuclei of endothelial cells. It's a very thin one. It's probably capillary. Sometimes there are little holes or fenestrations. It has a basement membrane. And look at, you see this little dark black thing here and there? Well, that's a red blood cell. And there's the nucleus once again of endothelial cell. And look, you could even see some mitochondria in it. And see those Fs? Those are your fenestrations. So it's always not a completely closed system. Now, the name of this first part of the saga will be called Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. And I've said this now for several years. I don't think anybody else has ever said it. But you have to think of the endothelium as being Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Remember, that was the play in which there was a really good doctor that sometimes would go into a fiendish monster. And that's what endothelium is. Endothelium In a way, endothelium is a lot like my dog Woofy, too. My dog Woofy is the gentlest, kindest animal you've ever seen. You could pet him, you could kiss him, you could hug him. He will lick you, he will protect you, he will die for you. Okay? That's Dr. Jekyll. But can I tell you something else about Woofy? If you mess with me, Woofy will rip your throat out. So, he really has a dual personality, and so does endothelium. In the normal hemostatic phase, endothelium is, first of all, an anatomic barrier to protect that extracellular matrix from platelets and blood cells, okay? It also degrades ADP. So you remember the platelets release ADP, adenosine diphosphate, and therefore it inhibits platelet aggregation. ADP is the main substance in the granules of the platelets which enhance aggregation. So it's being very protective. It's also an anticoagulant in other ways. Okay? It has heparin-like molecules along its membrane. That's an anticoagulant. It also makes a compound called thrombomodulin, which is the precursor or enhances the action of protein C, which is a very, very, very powerful anticoagulant in your body. And if you remember the tissue factor pathway of coagulation, well, it's an inhibitor to tissue factor. Finally, it even has fibrinolytic properties. So if it can't protect, you know, that blood clot from forming, if there is some fibrin that does form, guess what? It also has substances which dissolve it. TPA, tissue plasminogen activator. That's Dr. Jekyll. Now, I know you know what's coming next. This is Mr. Hyde. This is the monster. This is Woofy if you mess with me. On the other hand, if the endothelium is damaged in many ways, not just anatomically, one of the things it does is it makes von Willebrand factor, which we're going to talk about more in our chapter on coagulation. And von Willebrand factor, if you want to summarize it, you could say it's the main, even though it binds to factor 8, you know, it actually is the bridge between the platelets and the collagen of the extracellular matrix. Guess what? It also makes tissue factor with the cooperation of the platelets as well. So the tissue factor that triggers off the most powerful branch of the coagulation cascade is made by endothelium and platelets. Finally, it makes plasminogen inhibitors. So whereas you have plasminogen trying to dissolve the blood clot, the fibrin, you know, you are inhibiting it from doing it. So these are three ways that Mr. Hyde does his destructive evil work. What causes that endothelium to be messed with? Well, one thing is just anatomic breach, okay? Gunshot wound, knife wound, bruise. Okay, but don't be so much of an anatomic thinker. Think of the fact that there are substances released by a variety of infectious agents. You know, a lot of the gram-negative bacteria will react things that aggravates and destroys and disrupts Dr. Jekyll, the endothelium, so he becomes Mr. Hyde. Also, even the dynamics of blood flow. You know, normally blood flow is what we call smooth, we call laminar, it's nice. But let's say that there's something in there which disrupts the physics of those little flow vectors that you see, and the fluid becomes turbulent or it forms eddies. Well, that's another thing that will disrupt endothelium, even in absence of a specific physical force, other than the fact that the flow is being disturbed. Also, it could be activated by substances within the plasma, but the bottom line is, anything that you could possibly do to disrupt the integrity of that beautiful endothelial lining to your blood system is going to wind up changing it from Dr. Jekyll into Mr. Hyde. Now here's some platelets too. We're going to look at platelets, and you know it's not just the endothelium that's releasing the tissue factor to trigger off part 3, but you have platelets in part 2 here, and platelets have granules. We're going to look at the granules. Some of them are very dense, So the D for dense are also called delta granules. And the other ones are not quite so dense, but both of them have a lot of substances that the platelets need to do their job, of which the main one is to aggregate. So if you wanted to say what are the main general a reason for all of these granules and platelets, you could say it's for aggregation and ultimately the formation of tissue factor with endothelial cells. These are platelets, you know. You probably don't think that they look like platelets because all you remember seeing are those little purple dots on the blood smear, but here we have electron microscopy and here is bigger. And to see how some of these granules are very, very dense and black, these would be called the D or delta granules. And the ones that are a little not quite as black, like there, and probably a couple of these in here, those are the alpha granules with their variety of substances, of which one of the most important things is ADP. And I think ADP is in the delta granule. So these platelets, after they adhere, they then degranulate, and on the basis of degranulation, they do the third part of their act, which is aggregation. I actually have a movie here. I don't know if you want to see it. Let's look at it. You know, students love movies, and I actually made a nice little movie. So let's see if we can see it in action or whether it's not going to work. It decided not to work, I think. There you go. There's a degranulation. How do you like that? And it looks like it's not quite as dense as the one above it, so that's probably an alpha granule. And basically, it's the release of those granules. Platelets don't have a nuclei, they're just big bags of alpha and delta granules. And in the process of releasing those, they then complete their ultimate function in life, which is number one, to aggregate, and number two, release tissue factor with endothelium. Okay, I think we're back to the non-movie portion. So those are your three phases. The platelets adhere to the site of injury. They then secrete, and secrete is also called degranulation. And then finally, the end product of the platelet part of this play is aggregation. Once you have the formation of the platelet aggregate, you already are starting to overlap now with the final portion of the movie, which we're going to show you as the coagulation cascade. So the adhesion is primarily to the subendothelial ECM, because remember, the endothelium is gone. We know that the important substance, von Willebrand's factor, is the key substance in bridging those platelets. You have somebody that has von Willebrand's disease, a complex genetics scheme in which von Willebrand factor is absent, platelets are not able to do their job. And that could be a very serious disease. Okay? And finally, platelet secretion, second part, after adhesions, your alpha and delta granules. They're already binding agonists to the platelet surface. And what they do also chemically is they're involved in intracellular protein phosphorylation. So for those of you who like to think of it in terms of chemistry. Finally, your aggregation, the chief compound is ADP, also with some contribution from one of these eicosanoids called thromboxane A2. And then ultimately, the thrombin is part of the cascade, which ultimately forms the fibrin plug. And if you want to read more about the details, there you go. So once again, there's your platelet events, adherence of the ECM, secretion of ADP for, in other words, secretion, exposing the phospholipid complex, then creating the tissue factor. And if you remember, that tissue factor is then one of the most powerful thing in getting the coagulation scheme going. Formation of the primary plug, then the secondary plug is strengthened by fibrin. Okay, you know this is coming. So we got to talk about the final phase now, called the coagulation cascade. There's both an intrinsic and an extrinsic arm to it. And I know you've seen this diagram many times. And every time you ever hear a talk on coagulation, somebody's going to show it to you in a different format. It'll be confusing. You're going to wind up hating it. That's why the graph that I picked is going to be used by me in several portions of this course, because it's a simpler one, not totally simple, and it's consistent. And you have to remember that the general scheme of the coagulation cascade is for these various factors, which are called proenzymes, to be converted into true enzymes, usually by the action of a previous factor. The ultimate goal, then, is the conversion of prothrombin, which is factor Roman numeral 2, into thrombin, which is factor Roman numeral 2a, to act upon fibrinogen, which is factor 1, Roman numeral 1, into fibrin, the end product, Roman numeral 1a. There's some cofactors involved in this scheme. Calcium is very important. We know that phospholipid from platelet membrane is important. And they have to remember that some of these so-called Roman numeral factors are dependent on the vitamin K as their precursor. And the conversion of vitamin K into these factors takes place into the liver. And that's why people with liver disease bleed, is because they have deficiencies of these clotting factors if it's severe. You also remember that there are things called protein S and C and Z even, which act to counterbalance the cascade and control it and regulate it from happening. Okay, so there we go. I know this looks pretty hideous. I hate to do this, but I've already showed you this before. I'll probably show it to you a couple more times in different places. And here we go. Here's the intrinsic portion of the coagulation cascade. This does not need tissue factor. You have proenzyme factor 12 on the basis of being in contact with the damaged surface going to 12A. 12A converts 11 into 11A. 11A converts 9 into 9A. Now, 9A can then act on X factor 10 to go into 10A. And finally, we're pretty close to fibrin now, because 10A acts on prothrombin to become thrombin. And then thrombin converts fibrinogen to fibrin. And I know what you're thinking by now. You're thinking, why are there so many complex steps? Why don't they just have one arrow in here? And the reason for that is there has to be many levels of control. Now, that's the longer route. And by the way, it's not as powerful as the route that we referred to previously, called the extrinsic pathway, which is triggered off by tissue factor, which, as you remember, was that product from platelets and endothelial cells. Because traumatized tissue, now you got platelets in direct contact with endothelial cells, are going to act to create tissue factor. And tissue factor then takes factor 7A to convert it directly to the substance which is going to promote factor 10 going into 10A, which is now going to convert prothrombin to thrombin, and you know the rest of the drill, then fibrinogen to fibrin. So there you go, you got fibrin, you think that's the end, but then fibrinogen can become stronger and it can become cross-linked, or it can dissolve. And if you look at the red portions of the diaphragm here, of the diagram here, you have this intrinsic substance called active protein C. This is the control. This is the opposite of the coagulation thing. You have active protein C inhibiting 8 to go into 8A. It inhibits factor 5 to go into 5A. And of course, you remember that there are a sum total of events now working on this fibrin 1A to dissolve. And that's called fibrinolysis. That's what plasminogen is, a big, big, big factor there. Okay. So A lot of the stuff that we talked about might not seem very clinical. I'm going to tell you, when you're in the hospital and you got patients that you want to make sure they're not going to bleed to death during surgery, or they come in with bleeding disorders, or for any reason at all, you suspect that there might be some problem in their coagulation, and realizing that you're limited to money, there are a few simple tests you can do. And actually, I should have underlined the ones that are probably the most easy to do in the hospital setting. And I'll do that right now. The so-called partial thromboplastin time. Whoops, I made that in italic. The activated partial thromboplastin time. We usually called APTT, but in the older days, it was just called PTT. That is a general measure of the integrity of this intrinsic part of the diagram. So you have factor deficiencies in your intrinsic, which are specific for intrinsic. It's going to wind up as an abnormally elevated active partial thromboplastin time. As you might guess, if the intrinsic thing produces elevations of PTT, problems in the extrinsic pathway usually produce elevations of PT, or prothrombin time. The thing is, prothrombin time is no longer called PT, very rarely. It's generally transformed into a more scientific type thing called INR, International something something. I wish I could remember it. International Normalized Ratio is what it's called. And that's generally a measure of the right or the extrinsic part of the scheme. So PTT intrinsic, PT extrinsic. Patients that are on heparin therapy, you know, intravenous anticoagulation, are generally best monitored by APTT. And patients that are on oral anticoagulants, Coumadin compounds, Coumadin is a trade name, are best monitored by INR. So if you know somebody that's had a stroke or a pulmonary embolism or some kind of clot and they are on long-term Coumadin therapy, they have to go in and get their INRs every now and then. Another simple test, but it's not done quite as much anymore, is simply a bleeding time, and that's the easiest of all to understand. You make a little cut in the patient's skin, and then you keep blotting it every minute or so, and then you look to see when the blotting stops. And it usually stops somewhere between 2 and 9 minutes. So an elevated bleeding time means the platelet's bleeding too long, and it's usually a measure of either decreased or ineffective platelets. Now, the platelet count itself is a nice thing to do, and it's easy, and it's done every time somebody comes into the hospital and gets a CBC. It automatically spits out a normal platelet count. And even though it varies, it's about 150 to 400. Sometimes I've seen 100 to 300. You can also do a common assay for fibrinogen. The patient is low on fibrinogen. They're not going to be coagulating well, or they might be bleeding. And then, theoretically, although these are expensive, you could take any of those factors that I showed you here that have big Roman numerals, and you could actually do an assay. They're pretty expensive. If you're suspecting a hemophilia, you might actually do a factor 8 assay. Or if you're expecting a hemophilia B, you could do a factor 9 assay. Okay, let's see where we are, by the way. We have a few more things to talk about, but I just want to tell you, we've been through a lot of stuff. So I want you to take a big, big, big breath over here. And I imagine that Dr. Kamat has been very busy answering questions. I really appreciate that. But even though I really enjoy this chapter, I also realize that I threw a lot of stuff at you. And if you have not had a good physiology course, or some introduction to thrombosis or the enzymatic cascade already, I'm sure a lot of you have a spinning head right now. But let's talk about clinical stuff now. Let's talk about the formation of blood clots. Let's talk about thrombosis. Okay, what are some? What's the pathogenesis of thrombosis? Some of it we've referred to. We know that endothelial injury is the bottom line. Starts everything off. We know that alterations in flow. We know that there might be hypercoagulable states. We talked about reasons why patients might bleed too much, but what about patients that bleed too easily or too readily? I'm sorry, that clot too easily or too readily. Look at the morphology of blood clots, what they do, the fate of them, some clinical correlations, differentiating vein blood clots from artery blood clots, and then talking about blood clots adhering to the wall of the chambers of the heart, which are called mural, M-U-R-A-L, thrombi. Our favorite guy, Virchow again, who is our god of pathology, has a famous triangle. So it's called Virchow's triangle. And more than 100 years ago, he knew that if there was some endothelial damage or blood flow which was not smooth, turbulent, irregular, causing eddies, or hypercoagulable states, those were the three ends of Virchow's triangle. And guess what? That triangle still stands today, because when you look at all of the itemizations of things that we're going to talk about, they could all boil down to one of the three ends of the triangle. So endothelial injury, we've already talked about it. We're not going to say it again. But endothelial injury, the conversion of Dr. Jekyll into Mr. Hyde by all of those things, is really a main factor in forming a blood clot. We talked about endothelium. I'm not going to say that again. Here are the three things that make Dr. Jekyll such a nice guy. And here are the three things that make Mr. Hyde such a heinous monster. The thing that we could expand on a little bit is abnormal flow. Now, normally, endothelium relies on having a smooth laminar flow on the side of it called the lumen. But if there are disruptions in those little vectors of flow, which the physicists like to draw, that's called turbulence, okay? It's like turbulence in an airplane. If you are going through nice smooth air, you could go to sleep. If there's turbulence, the plane is bouncing you all over the place. Well, it's also messing with the endothelium as well. Those are called eddies, or little curly cues in your vectors that the physicists draw. On the other hand, even stasis of blood flow, not turbulence, but the opposite of turbulence, no blood flow, stasis or sluggish blood flow, that's going to wind up messing with the endothelial cells too. Bottom line is, abnormal flow is a factor for disrupted endothelium. You know, and that's the other end of Virchow's triangle. And once that endothelium is disrupted, you now have the platelets in direct contact with the tissue below the endothelium. What about hypercoagulability? There are certain inherited conditions, and we're going to mention some of them briefly, which result in hypercoagulable blood. Actually, there's a whole bunch of it, and I'm only going to mention a couple. By far, the commonest one would be a defect in factor V or prothrombin. So genetically caused or inherited defects in factor V and prothrombin are like probably the main causes of hypercoagulable blood, blood that will coagulate too readily. Another common thing is a mutation in the prothrombin gene, and the mutation results in a problem with methylene, let me sure I pronounce it right, methylene ester tetrahydrofolate, if you want to go specifically, you know, where the chemical is. On the other hand, some of the rarer inherited hypercoagulability states is an antithrombin 3 deficiency. And remember, we have these things called protein C, protein S, protein Z. These are the ones that are preventing or regulating or controlling the coagulation. Well, if the controlling substances are defective, then it goes out of control. Finally, there are even genetic defects, and I'm not going to go into them, in which you do not have proper fibrinolysis. So all of these things would explain why certain patients are born with hypercoagulable defects. And I guarantee you, if there is a question on the board in which you're dealing with a hypercoagulation, it's going to wind up being either factor 5 or prothrombin, most likely, as a defect. You saw this already. I'm not going to say anything more about it, but I am going to tell you, by the time this course is over, I'm going to show this so many times, and here's another one, you're going to have to memorize it. And believe me, there are a lot worse diagrams than this. And of course, when you go to these meetings, when your drug salesmen are trying to sell you some expensive anticoagulant, you know, they're going to give you the same type of diagram, only going to put the name of their company on the top over there. What about acquired hypercoagulability? This is sort of a memory list, but I think some of them make sense. People that are on prolonged bed rest or immobilization are hypercoagulable. What's the reason for that? Stasis. Okay? People that have had myocardial infarcts, what's the reason for that? Lack of perfusion in areas and probably stasis. What about atrial fibrillation? That's a big one. You can assume that somebody that has inadequate or fluttery or non-uniform contraction of the atria is very much at risk for a big blood clot, an atrial mural thrombus. And why is that? It's because myocardium that flutters and doesn't contract smoothly is going to be abnormal, turbulent, eddy flow. Okay, patients that have had tissue damage with the release of tissue factor, whether it's surgery, fracture, burns, this is logical too. Those patients are going to be hypercoagulable. You also remember that there is a syndrome called Trousseau's syndrome, T-R-O-U-S-S-E-A-U, and it's originally described with pancreas carcinoma patients winding up having venous thrombosis, and often it's migratory. It goes in one area, then it goes in another area. But it's expanded now to be in general in cancer patients, especially gastrointestinal cancers, colon cancer, pancreas cancer. And patients with those things have substances, glycoprotein-like substances, which are ultimately responsible for a hypercoagulable state. Prosthetic cardiac valves? Sure, it's a foreign substance. It might even cause abnormal flow, wouldn't it? Because it's not normal like real heart valves. That's another reason for hypercoagulability. Disseminated intravascular coagulation, well, that goes without saying. In disseminated intravascular coagulation, or DIC, you basically have almost every artery, tiny blood vessel in your blood forming little blood clots simply because there is very, very poor perfusion. So that's why DIC often goes hand in hand with shock. There's another situation called heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. And I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, if the patient is thrombocytopenic and doesn't have platelets, why should he be hypercoagulable? Why shouldn't he be hypocoagulable? Well, this little paragraph down there explains it, and you could read it, and I hope you do. But this is kind of a situation in which you would expect a lack of coagulation because of decreased patients, but in this case, you have hypercoagulability. There's also substances produced in diseases like lupus, something called a antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. Okay, lupus patients make antibodies against phospholipids, and these phospholipids, if they're damaged, would result in a hypercoagulable state. Now, here are some general things. Patients with cardiomyopathies, nephrotic syndrome, you all know that estrogens, you know, birth control pills, hormone replacement therapy. Women are always afraid that they might get blood clots. There is some statistical correlation in certain cases, although your drug reps will tell you that, you know, there's no problem with it, and they'll show you scientific stuff. Just remember, estrogens themselves generally promote coagulation. That includes oral contraceptive. What about sickle cell patients in which their blood cells are sickling in small vessels are very, very likely to coagulate as well. Even very, very simple things like smoking and obesity have a statistical relationship to hypercoagulability. Okay, guess what, folks? The rest of this material here is very, very clinical, and we're going to be talking and looking at blood clots, but it's already quitting time, and I'm sorry it is, because I've been enjoying this so much, but I know you've been working hard, so I am going to reward you by not making you work harder, but I also know you've been having fun, because I've been having fun. So next, and we're not obviously going to have a lab today, but we're done with the majority of the PowerPoints, and in the next session, we'll finish this up, plus have a lot of microscopic laboratory cases in histopathology lab, which will demonstrate a lot of the things that we're talking about. Okay, I'm going to pop open the window because I haven't looked at it for a long time. I can see a lot of questions, and I am going to assume that Dr. Kamat has been busy answering him. I asked him if he was disturbed by all those questions, and he goes, no, I love it. So, you know, I'm really happy to hear that. I guess we could play our final song now. It's also kind of a beautiful, inspirational song. It's not religious. It's one of the few songs that made me cry a long time ago. So it's a very, very emotional type of song. And if you've ever seen the movie with Christopher Reeve called Somewhere in Time, you might remember that there was a theme song to it. So we'll close off today's session with the theme to Somewhere in Time. And I thank you very much for showing up, and we will see you in 46 hours. Rock on, you buzzards.